All right, we are back from our break and continuing on with this Memorial Day 2012 Satsang-A-Thon. 2012, very important year. This is the year that has been foretold to bring about troubles. If we look at the world right now, everyone sees fragility. Okay, there's a lot of fragility around the world. But what we're not sure about is if there will be a precipitating event that will expose this fragility. And of course, there very well could be. So what we're doing is preparing for the worst case scenario. But actually, existence itself is a worst case scenario. In that we're trying to forget what we are. We're trying to replace what we are with something that we think is better. We're trying to replace spirit with prime being. We're trying to make spirit into prime creator. We're spirit, and we're trying to get rid of our identity and replace it with that the identity of prime creator. And that causes so many, many, many troubles for us. We didn't really foresee the troubles. We didn't realize. We didn't know what would happen. But now we know. And the troubles are so, so many. But the remedy is very simple. And so, in these satsangs, we just point out that the remedy is to choose a new idea. Very simple. Couldn't be more simple than that. Now, we're doing this satsang-a-thon because on Memorial Day, it's traditional to do the muscular dystrophy telethon. It's been going on for a long, long time, raising a lot of money, a lot of awareness, a lot of support, etc. So what we're doing here, excuse me for 1 second. Let me keep going. That is spam texting. Wonderful. You have one. Go to this. You see, nobody's immune from that spam texting. On Memorial Day, even. Wow. Have they no shame? And part two of this telethon, satsang-a-thon. Anyway, back to muscle dystrophy. This is something that, along those lines, not raising any money, just putting out support, encouragement, awareness, that we need to consider a worst-case scenario, and we need to realize that existence actually is a worst-case scenario for us. And so any effort we make to clarify is extremely beneficial for us. Very, very helpful. Saves us enormous suffering. And ultimately, we talked about in part two how we could sidestep the whole situation and why we should not feel guilty about that. The whole world it runs on blackmail, to tell you the truth. Everyone here is being blackmailed in some way. Seems that way. You wonder why there's not more talk about this situation, why there's not more direct, decisive talk, because of blackmail. I myself have been blackmailed. Absolutely, the pressure is on. The pressure. In fact, my whole life has been blackmailed. Been several occasions where basically I was put in a situation I could have been killed, and I said if I just shut up, my life will be spared, but I can't say anything about what's going on. So that, you know, intimidated me into silence. And the reason why people aren't speaking up, they're intimidated into silence by blackmail, by saying, well, if you talk up, we're going to do something to you, we're going to reveal something. The ego works to blackmail everyone here. Really, the ego works through blackmail. Get some kind of compromising information on someone, lead them into a dark place, get compromising information on them, and then blackmail them. I guarantee you that throughout the government and business and everywhere, everyone, there's so much blackmail going on. It's not spoken about, but it's understood that, hey, you do what I want or else I'm going to really cause you troubles. So I'm speaking up even though I'm under the threat of blackmail. Because it's very important, it's crucial. Now is the time to come to the defense of truth. Now is the time. Jesus said to those who are given much, much is expected. And if you don't stand up and share the truth, then he'll say, you know, who are you? I don't know you. In other words, you didn't share the truth. Don't hide your light under a bushel. Let it shine. In spite of blackmail and threats and all of that, that's vitally important. Otherwise, there'd be no voice in the world at all. And sometimes when teachers get into economic arrangements with the world, then there are also situations that put pressures are put to bear, like, you know, you need to do this in order to continue the profits coming in, and you need to emphasize this and de-emphasize that, and if you want to remain mainstream, front page, etc., you need to, you know, play ball, do business, you know, with the world. So here, I'm not in that type of situation. There's no economics involved with this situation. So I can pretty much just say whatever I want to say. The only thing I wouldn't say is something that's saying it brings about diminishing returns, really. There are certain things that could be said, but they would irritate people so much that it's really not worth it to say, because the backlash would be so severe and the help would be minimal. But ego has sacred cows in this world, and you don't want to criticize those sacred cows simply because people are too intimidated. They're under blackmail from those sacred cows not to criticize them. Those who are loyal to the ego, do the ego's work and the ego's agenda, the ego protects them through blackmail, through sanctions, through all sorts of penalties, legal penalties. Anybody who speaks out against them will be severely reprimanded. So it doesn't serve much of a purpose, and it's not necessary, because the ego can be criticized directly. The entire situation can be pointed out directly. And that's way more helpful. Way more helpful. So here we are in part 3 of the Satsang-A-Thon. Maybe we should just keep this rolling. Who knows? Because we're going to need it. If a worst-case scenario crops up, let's say one country A attacks country B, for instance, and that brings country C in to protect country B, and that brings country D in to protect country A, and before you know it, step by step by step, the world's pulled into war. We've seen this happen many times on this planet already. It's not something new here. So we should not be so naive with our heads in the sand thinking this can't happen. I'd say there's a better than a 50-50 chance that it will happen. I have not foreseen specifically country A attacking country B. I have not seen that. But it would not be a surprise if it took place. And that would certainly precipitate a run on banks. Why? Because people want cash to buy durable goods and food. The money in the bank, when a world war breaks out, money in the bank isn't doing anyone any good. Interest rates are likely to plunge, the bank's likely to go under, money may be frozen. Very possible that the assets are frozen. So people will try as fast as possible to get all their money out of the bank and buy durable goods, food, generators, gasoline, heaters, blankets, all these sorts of durable goods that enable people to get by during tough times, during rationing, etc. And rationing will come very quickly. Rationing on gasoline and food. Many things will not be sold. You might not be able to buy various communication devices. Be a crackdown across the board. So first thing that happens is a run on banks. Should the hostilities break out, significant hostilities, for instance, in the Middle East, be a run on banks. And that'll collapse the banks. And the financial structure will go under. Banks won't have any more money to lend. They'll have to shut down. And gridlock, financial gridlock. People will flee to durable goods. They'll buy seeds. And freezing, like the freezing internet commerce could happen. All sorts of things could happen right away, very quickly. It's probably a whole set of plans, contingency plans, how to maintain civil order in the wake of hostilities breaking out, significant hostilities. But even if the world wasn't plunged into war immediately, the run on the banks would happen because people could see the writing on the wall and they said, wow, this has a very good chance of turning into something really, really bad. And we have to get our money out. And of course, banks run on people's money being in the banks. So when the banks collapse, the whole financial structure, Wall Street, etc., collapses. World financial system collapses. Governments have to issue credits, you know, some type of credit system, some type of super rationing system where everyone has like a number and they're allocated, you know, a certain amount of credits, probably some sort of digital system, which brings us to the possibility of some type of tattoo, some type of REM chip, some type of implant that has data, the person's all the personal data and their quota, ration quota, and then that's scanned. One goes to the gas station, you know, there's a scanner there, and one then can say, you know, get certain amount of gas depending on what they're allocated. And of course, allocations will go to necessity. Some people have very, very low allocations and really cannot move around at all. So really a conflict breaking out from country A and country B and pulling some other countries into it, etc., would at this time in the world, it could very well lead to just a lockdown, a real lockdown. To maintain civil order, you would think there would be a draconian lockdown. I don't believe the governments are simply going to allow the marketplace, laissez-faire marketplace rules under such a contingency. Certainly, I believe that they will institute a severe lockdown. So that's the surface type of situation, that's worst case scenario, that actually is a likely, if not probable, scenario right now. Again, I don't have any particular foresight about a war, but I do have the foresight about the financial structure collapsing. And that could certainly be brought about by hostilities breaking out, run on the banks. So, where does that leave everybody? Well, in the part two of this Satsang-A-Thon, I talked about how there are those in this world, very powerful now, they're in control of the world, really, who demand that everybody stay here on this planet. Why? Because they are really engaging in sacrificial games here. Instead of a coliseum, a rink where the spectators go and watch these brutal blood sports, instead of just a coliseum, the whole world is now the coliseum. And there are those who are getting off on the sacrifice of as many as possible here. Just the sheer fear and terror and suffering and misery that gives them the hit, the drug that they're looking for, which is a distraction from turning to truth, turning to satsang. They're looking for very strong distraction because they've used up the other distractions and they know they don't work. And so they're desperate for a stronger distraction. So that's why they're here. And they have planned out a blueprint that they're following to bring about maximum suffering here on this planet. And they don't want anybody to leave. They don't want anyone to sidestep the suffering. They want They don't want any exit route, because if there's an exit route, there's hope. Where there's hope, there's a turning towards reason and clarity, to clarify it. There's a lessening of panic, there's a lessening of fear, a lessening of hostility, and the whole thing gets sort of denuded of its intensity. So, that is why you are not hearing anything about options, very little about options. You're not hearing very little about sidestepping the future of this planet. The future of this planet, the plans for this planet are very, very, very dark and dire. Custom made for those who want to get off on the suffering. Who want to immerse themselves in the schadenfreude of the times, enjoying others' tragedy, and feeling empowered through that by being able to continue to distract themselves from clarification of and remembrance of what they really are, because they believe that what they really are has been destroyed. It's no longer there. And so it's either strengthen this identity or have none at all. So for them it's a survival, it's a survival situation, not physical but spiritual survival. They really feel they're going to be annihilated if they don't keep being distracted from looking within, from turning towards truth. And so they take this very serious, and they need this intense distraction of suffering of others, which is very distracting. It captivates their interest, you know, the torment, the torture, and the catastrophes, and the starving, and just the misery, and all that. It catches their attention. They look at it with full attention, very, very interested in it. That engages their attention, so it doesn't turn towards choosing a new idea, remembrance of what they are. So it doesn't turn in that direction. So, there are those who have no interest or purpose in the suffering and misery of this world. And so, they need to sidestep the future of this planet, because the future of this planet doesn't have anything to offer them. So how do you sidestep it is the question. Must be a way. I've certainly seen myself sidestepping it all. Quite a few times in dreams I found myself being able to sidestep the future. There is a way. But we are dissuaded from taking that route because out of guilt. Out of guilt that, again, that if these entities that are here to immerse themselves in the suffering of this planet, the people of this planet, and all the mayhem, death and misery, sacrifice, mayhem here, they believe that if they don't get the full dose, that they're going to be annihilated themselves. They're going to be annihilated. Their spirits will be annihilated. This is a lie that they're telling themselves. But they believe the lie. So they don't want anyone leaving. And they claim that if anyone leaves, that leaving might cause them to be annihilated. And that the annihilation will then be on the hands of the ones that left, you know. And that they have to carry that guilt, that eternal guilt, for having a soul, a spirit being annihilated, aspect of spirit being annihilated. That's a lie. It's a 100% complete, total lie, because spirit cannot be annihilated. So these are some things that were highlighted in part two that are very important to carry forward here. Spirit cannot be annihilated, cannot be harmed in any way. And whatever letdowns someone might have for not being sufficiently distracted, the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason, immediately uses that to turn them towards clarification. So there is no gap, there is no letdown, there is no abandonment, there is no annihilation at all, none. And sidestepping the situation will actually be extremely beneficial for everybody here, extremely beneficial. It will let those who seem to be on the fence know there is a way, there is an option. It will let those who are trying to get maximal sacrifice here not get it, which may lead them to be worried enough that they turn towards truth and they give up their intensity a little bit, feeling like, wow, we really failed, we failed somehow, and start to second guess themselves, which gives an opportunity for reason to say, hey, take a look at this instead, you know, this other way doesn't work. So it's beneficial there. For those who are leaning towards sidestepping, by sidestepping it, they get empowered and say, yeah, it's possible. It's the right thing to do. Helps them. It's a very, very helpful thing. There's no guilt associated with that at all. Just as there's no real guilt associated with reality at all, and even with existence at all, because everyone has equal access to choosing a new idea right now. Nobody can block it at all. So there's no grounds for actual guilt. There's plausible guilt. There's guilt based on false premises. Like the premise that if one is not sufficiently distracted, then one will be annihilated. That's a false premise. But if one accepts that premise, then of course guilt will arise from that. Just the very desire to sidestep will bring up guilt. Crippling guilt. You're thinking, how can I be so selfish that I want to save myself from suffering, and in doing that, I'm going to cause the annihilation of these others. And one will say, well, I know that my death won't cause my annihilation, but if I save myself, it might cause the annihilation of these others. So it would be a terribly selfish thing to sidestep it. That's the rationale that's based on a lie. You know, any severe addict will claim that they have to get the next fix, otherwise something terrible will happen to them. Therefore, it's justified. But in this case, the addiction is so gigantic, it says that literally they think that their spirit will be expunged, you know, forever. They will cease to be. So, and you can't get any more dramatic than that. This is a 100% pure, unadulterated lie, like all lies. No such possibility exists. It's just a clever, clever, clever rationalization for the addiction. It's just a way to cling to the hope that one can be prime creator. One can experience that. And if it means destroying a whole planet, you know, they think, well, the ends justify the means. There again, nobody is blocking anyone else from choosing a new idea, choosing the idea of not trying to be prime creator and experiencing the perfect overlay, which is the effect of that idea. No one's blocking anyone from that. Never. Can't be blocked. So there's no guilt over that. So through and through, there's no guilt. Especially when one wants to choose safety, choose a sidestep, crises, and vast sacrificial events. When one says, no, I'm not interested in that, that's totally legitimate. Now, in the past, we could go to a different place, you know, somehow sidestep it here. In this situation, it's maybe a bit different. Might be tough to sidestep it here. I mean, I guess it's possible, but maybe it's not going to work out that way that we can sidestep it here. It's best to take the safe way, the certain way. So, these are topics that are coming up for conversation all over the world, all over the internet, where people continue to consider what options there might be, as there's a genuine general understanding of the times that we live in and how they are potentially very questionable. We could potentially be put under draconian laws, executive orders, international treaties that we're bound by. The whole world will be bound by a set of treaties. If the world really starts disintegrating into a conflict, there could be a set of international agreements, but everyone is bound by those agreements, and the sovereignty of each country will be surrendered to that. And the agreements may be very, very, very strict. Rights could be suspended. And don't think that if there is a severe conflict that somehow there's going to be a body of people who have the capacity to stand up to that and say, no, freedom is more important. You know, no, they'll say civil unrest must be avoided at all costs. Basically, that's the government's first purpose, is to keep the peace, keep civil peace, keep unrest from happening. And so whatever steps are necessary to prevent that civil unrest will be taken. And again, this could happen any time. Could happen tomorrow. Could happen on later today. Could happen in June. Could happen in July. Some aggressive action could be taken. And the world would be split on it. You know, there'd be all sorts of differing, you know, split opinions on it, which gives rise to conflict, doesn't it? All sorts of interests in this world. There's a very scarcity of materials, natural resources in this world now, and there are a lot of countries who are desperate to get their hands on additional resources. And for them, it's survival of their country depends on it. They want to avoid civil unrest in their own country. In order to do that, they have to have enough raw materials to carry out enough manufacturing to keep everybody happy. And so, again, this where issues of survival crop up, reason goes out the window. The duty of anyone on the path of remembrance is to put reason and clarity first, and you never throw them out the window. Doesn't matter what the situation arises, you don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. It just isn't done. So reason is not sacrificed under any pretext or conditions. One still must state the basic truth. Existence is just this hypothetical dream scenario the mind is presenting as a means of inducing spirit into a condition of forgetfulness of what it is. My spirit chose the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator. Mind said, okay, here it is, but it's only a pretense. It's only a pretend. Spirit can never actually experience being prime creator. It's impossible. These are the basics, and one needs to be reminded of this. We have the capability, under any circumstances, to focus in on this. Now, what I've done is focus in on this for a great length of time and make myself viable. Should worst case scenario break out, perhaps I can help others remain focused in the right way by continuing to emphasize what is all important, even under dire world war situations, where everything in the world is falling apart, still there's this voice focusing on what is essential and saying, you know, do this first. This is more important than anything that's going on in the world, because it is way more important. Because whatever is taking place in the world right now is just a tiny, tiny, tiny drop in existence. And existence continually presents these drops of conflict. On and on and on and on and on. That's what it does. That's what its purpose is. And so we have to see through this and decide to choose a different idea, which will have different effect with it. We have to get to that point where we choose a new idea. And otherwise, we'll be dragged down by the ego's agenda of forgetfulness into deeper and deeper forgetfulness, more and more intense forgetfulness, and more reinforcement. And that leads to great delay on our part, great misery, births and deaths, births and deaths, births and deaths, over and over and over, going through this grinder, meat grinder of a world, the meat grinder of existence, and lamenting it and regretting it all, and feeling confused and isolated and alone and alienated and unhappy, all of that will come with it if we do not continue our focus on what is true and how to get, what's the remedy for all of this craziness here? What's the remedy for the world flipping out, going berserk, acting in a whimsical, irrational way? What's the remedy? The remedy is to be reminded of the RX. What is the true RX, the true remedy? That's simply to choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, and experience that, the one effect from that idea, which is a non-modifying effect, effect that is not being modified in any way. You might say it's the presence of isness, presence of stillness. There simply is the stillness, and the quality remains exactly the same always. Not up and not down. The wind doesn't push it around. The heat doesn't touch it, doesn't boil it. The cold doesn't freeze it. It's not affected by nature. It doesn't arise from nature. It's in the world, but not of it, so to speak. It's overlaying the world, but it's not of it. It's not being produced by the world. Not being produced by the idea of trying to be prime creator. So this experiencing, abiding in this effect is most certainly the best thing we can do, and that's most certainly the remedy that we can employ. No matter where we are, what our situation is, we can employ that remedy. Abide in that remedy. The feeling of the presence of isness, presence of stillness, presence of perfect peace, seamless peace. No seam, no fragmentation, no change. Immaculate, clear, bright, perfect. Just abide in that. Everyone can do that. Every single aspect of spirit on this planet can do that. And the whole cosmos, it can be done by all aspects of spirit. Very simply, right this minute. Right this minute. And when times get tough, one has to be reminded of this and stick with it. One cannot say, well, that used to be true, but I'm sure the whole situation has now been modified, because look at all the modification going on the planet. Look at this incredible change that we've been plunged into. It's impossible, you know, we think it's impossible that the whatever effect there's there, the isness, it cannot be affected by this. That's impossible. There's the trouble right there. Actually, it's impossible that it is affected. It's impossible that it can be affected in any way. It's the idea of non-modification, not being affected. And that idea does not have any effects that are changeable or affected by anything. And so when we have access to this information, even in the midst of a draconian crackdown, terrible financial collapse, and all these, you know, dust-ups all over the world and confusion, everybody will be in complete financial confusion. Complete confusion about food, necessities, finances, everything, if the worst-case scenario plays out as I have seen it play out. And again, of course, I'm not infallible, so it's possible that it doesn't play out. That's why I call it worst-case scenario. Should the worst-case scenario play out, then certainly people would be sort of paralyzed by the uncertainty and confusion and inability to function the way they're used to functioning, and just like feel like they're just trapped. What do we do? And no one knows. And then there's a tendency to fall into despair, fall into whimsical behavior, irrational behavior. All sorts of stuff can happen, all sorts of situations. And people may jump into ghost dancing or start, people just start dancing. Dance-a-thons, you know, might begin to raise money, to raise community hope, to bring about peace. I mean, I'm sure that what will happen is there will be many situations of people trying to bring about world peace by engaging in all sorts of rituals, you know, dance-a-thons, pray-a-thons. Now, a Satsang-A-Thon, which I have coined here, it's different. It reminds you of what the remedy really is, where your freedom really is. It's not trying to bring about world peace. It's trying to bring about you choosing peace. Okay, it's about choosing peace, not imposing peace. Peace cannot be imposed. Treaties can be signed to bring about cessation of overt conflict. But real peace is a choice, and it's an effect from another idea. It's not ever the effect of the idea that we're presently entertaining, the idea of wanting to experience being prime creator. It's never effect of that, never. There's only temporary cessations of conflict that we define as eras of peace. But if we look at the history of this planet, I mean, we've had much more conflict here than we've had peace, times of peace. I mean, there are many, I mean, there are times when wars last for 100 years or more. Conflicts are historic, go way back, and there are times when just constant warfare, constant attack, constant conflict. There's very, and then interspersed with the, you know, meager amounts of relative peacefulness, or not overt conflict, only for the conflict to come back. That's been the history of this planet. Why should we believe that somehow that this is all gone for good? I mean, where do we get that optimism? Why? Because everybody's educated? I remember viewing a video online about an educator in India who was helping out orphans, untouchable class. Very altruistic, noble thing to do, and which is great, give them an education. But the reasoning behind this was, I noticed that deep behind this, there's the notion that if everyone is educated, then nobody will have to do any dirty work, you know. But then I asked the obvious question, well, who's going to do the dirty work then? Is the dirty work going to magically disappear simply because everyone is now educated? So no more garbage? When we're all educated, there won't be a need for anyone to clean our toilets anymore, take out the trash, pick up the trash, garden, maintain our yards, patch the roads, dig the coal out of the ground, you know, do all the mining, you know, all the maintenance work, all the building work, all the dangerous stuff, all the, you know, no one's gonna have to dispose of dead people. I mean, all that vast array of work that, you know, is very dirty, difficult, dangerous, lousy work. If everyone's white collar, will blue collar, all the blue collar jobs just vanish? No need for them anymore. No more need for welders. No more need for auto mechanics. You know, is that really going to happen? No more need for truck drivers. So if we're all educated, does that mean we all have great jobs? Well, look at the flawed logic in that. It's incredibly flawed logic. No, the truth is that all of those jobs will still have to be done by someone. But the notion is that, well, if I'm educated, at least I won't have to do it. And then that's rational. I say, well, let's educate everybody, then no one will have to do it. But that is not looking at the situation at all. People will keep dying. You know, people will keep getting sick. Everything that is done right now will still have to be done, even if we're all educated. I'm super educated. I still have to do the dirty work. Didn't vanish. So it's ludicrous to think that somehow a corollary to that is that somehow we can teach peace and impose peace in the world, as if the work of conflict will disappear if we all are educated into peace, so to speak. Let's all sign treaties as if that's going to solve the problems, the conflicts of the world. No, it won't. So it's largely a waste of time. I mean, it's good that conflicts can cease, but it is a delusion to think that that is peace. It's only a temporary, very temporary. There is no such thing as a war to end all wars. Never has been, never will be. Especially on this planet, we're running out of space, we're running out of agriculture. Some places in Africa, the population is such that they cannot squeeze any more food out of where they're at all. And the population is getting too much, and there's bound to be wars simply over land for food. There's bound to be wars over oil and fossil fuels. As we've reached the point of diminishing returns on all of that. There's people will fight over resources. You cannot just preach peace to someone who's starving. I mean, I guess that the notion is that that somehow if we educate people to be passive enough that they'll simply starve passively and won't, you know, the haves will maintain what they have and the have-nots will just die in the streets. I mean, that happened in Bengal. World War II. Didn't have any food. They ran out of food. Distribution system was locked down to prevent it from being used by the Japanese. Boats were all locked down. Distribution system was locked down. And a lot of the countryside was razed so that the invading army, if they invaded, they wouldn't have any supplies. They couldn't find any food in the country that they invaded, so try to starve the invaders out. But what happened was the people that lived there got starved, were starved. How many? 2, 3 million, 4 million, 5 million people died just through starvation, middle class people. Because the farmers already had land and could live off the land in some way and survive. The rich people had money and they hoarded it. And then the middle class, who makes money off of serving the rich people, off of providing goods and services, etc., they didn't get any more money. They had nothing. They had no land and they had no means to buy any food because the rich stopped spending their money and spent it all on hoarding to pay for what meager food was available at super high prices. They stopped employing the middle class. So the middle class had nothing, no food, no money. Starved to death. Got covered up. I mean, 3 to 6 million people may have starved to death. I don't know. It was a very huge number. And they did it passively. You know, just sitting in their huts, sitting on the side of the road, just starving to death. So sometimes teaching peace in this world is teaching passivity, knowing that scarcity is coming and the haves want the have-nots to just die peacefully and not go after their goods. You have to look at that. Whereas satsang teaches choosing peace, the effect, an effect which is perfectly stable, which helps, it gives us the perfect reminder of what we are, which is spirit, in which there is no scarcity whatsoever. It's a completely different orientation. A lot of the teachings of this world, they're egoic, and they play out in ways where the haves teach an ideology which tries to insulate themselves from the have-nots. It's just common sense. This has happened throughout history, that the haves are always spinning out some ideology that trains the have-nots to not attack the haves and take what they have. They're making treaties with other countries and just trying, the haves try to keep what they have, and hopefully hoping that the have-nots, you know, remain unempowered and passive enough not to go after it. And so a lot of religious teachings and various teachings, ideologies, beliefs, etc., inculcate that type of attitude among the have-nots. But satsang is entirely different. Satsang says that everyone has equal access to choosing a new idea right this minute and experiencing the perfect peace, the presence of isness, perfect, is still unchanging isness right this moment. Everyone, equal access. A starving Bengali and a rich Bengali would have the same access. No different. Now, would that access bring about temporal relief here in the world? Possible. Maybe, maybe not. It wouldn't matter either way. Because one would realize that the body is really nothing. On the same hand, if the body is as useful as a communication device, it certainly could be strengthened from within. Those who live and dwell in and are immersed in this perfect remembrance of what they are, this overlay, this peace beyond understanding, they literally can live on almost no food at all, if necessary, or they can eat large amounts, if necessary. Their bodies function a different way. They're not vulnerable, like we are used to talking about vulnerability. So choosing to experience, to abide in peace, the peace beyond understanding, that is the right move to make under all circumstances. That's the right choice under all circumstances. So it's better to spend time on satsang than it is to try and bring peace to the world. Because peace cannot be brought to this world. This world can be overlaid by peace, but it's a complete overlay, without exception. Everything is overlaid equally. You either have complete peace or none at all. What we have in this world is only relative cessation of overt conflict, temporary cessation of overt conflict. That's all we really have in this world. And renewed conflicts are a certainty. As are draconian laws to try and prevent conflict. So the Satsang-A-Thon, maybe we can continue that. Should a worst case scenario break out? Possible. If that's what the voice of reason is looking for, that it could be continued. Maybe we can have more participants. Who's to say that it can't become a broadcast feature to help rally those in the world who really want to drop their distraction and turn towards remembrance, and really are not interested in the song and dance of conflict in the world and troubles, and really want to choose to experience perfect peace beyond understanding the presence of isness. It's the perfect stillness. That's the goal. Well, they certainly could use encouragement. You can use encouragement right now, always in existence, but never more so than what's coming up in the future, near future here. So this is, you know, we're starting our, I guess Memorial Day might be the starting of this Satsang-A-Thon. What better time to kick it off on Memorial Day, beginning of summer? Actually, it's quite cool here right now in the Bay Area, but I believe it's going to be a long, hot summer around the world. It certainly is. Tempers can rise during the summertime. Scorching heat, maybe the hottest summer on record, who knows? And tempers boil over, frustrations boil over. People become irrational. There's no future. They become irrational. They jump into magical thinking. Once one jumps into magical thinking, there's nothing that can be done except put them in a straitjacket. Because reason doesn't work. Calm discussion doesn't work. Calm discussion is essential. You can't, on a whim, start throwing a bunch of emotions around. When one is having a discussion, there has to be calm, very civil calm, and nobody feels threatened. Nobody's waving hands and pounding the table, shouting and acting in belligerent ways. Nobody is trying to use that type of intimidation. They simply stay very calm, very composed, and put everything out on the table, the marketplace of ideas, and then look at what's on the table and see what looks the best. It has to be done in a serene way, non-threatening way. One has to feel that one is making a choice based on clarity rather than intimidation and fear and expediency. So it's very important that satsang is always very civil. Nobody's threatening or shouting. Even though the world may be losing its head, collective head, in satsang, we remain calm. Because what we're considering requires calmness to observe it. And to make a wise decision, choose the right option, one needs to see through the ego's tricks and threats and guilt and all this lies that the ego constantly throws up as roadblocks for us. Every time we take a step, the ego says, oh, wait a minute, hold up there, you know, there's just another problem. We examine that and we say, oh, no, that's not really a problem. Then we take another step. The ego throws up another objection. And one can never get past the ego's objections forcefully or emotionally. One has to be very calm and collected and non-reactive, open-eared, objective, and simply look at the situation and begin to notice it carefully. What's the ego really saying? Where is it coming from? Where's the threat really? What's the actual dynamics? And what's very important with satsang is that we able to emphasize the very roots of the whole situation, which then puts the ego in the right light, and we're easily able to reject its crazy notions, because we know that it's bound to its purpose of lies, absolutely bound to it, and will always lie, will always deceive, will always misguide us, will always see us in the context of its purpose, which is to continue to inculcate deep forgetfulness of what we are. Continue that to induce us to remain in this state of deep forgetfulness and to prevent us from turning back towards remembrance. That's the ego's purpose. Prevent us from turning back towards remembrance. So it tries to scare us away, intimidate us away, give us false reasons, give us false endeavors that seem to be noble to pursue. Anything and everything throws the kitchen sink at the situation. And we cannot get flustered about it, or frustrated or flustered. One has to remain calmly resolute. And that's not easy to do. It takes a lot of practice, a lot of progress, a lot of success. And in a time of the world going crazy, it's not a time for neophytes to succeed at this. It's necessary to have those who are already good at it, very, very capable of it, to help out, set the tone, set the tempo. When chaos breaks out, it's helpful to have an orchestra leader, conductor. Conductor keeps the orchestra together. Says, "Keep playing, keep playing. Keep playing this beautiful music." Yeah. And they look to the conductor to maintain their tempo, maintain their poise, and know when to play. It's like that. The Satsang-A-Thon. Maybe I can invite some friends. I don't know where they're at, but it'd be nice to have some contributions here. Possible. I'll keep an open mind to it. I can invite someone here to do some taping. I tape direct to YouTube for several reasons. One is that my eyes are giving out. I really have horrible eyesight. Weak eyes, not only terrible vision, but eyesight, but they're weakening because I used them too much, and they're inherited very weak eyes, and the computer work of putting together videos is so time consuming, and I'm staring at this my depth of perception is just flat, you know, about 14 inches, and just stays that way for hours and hours at a time, vast amounts of time, trying to put together, edit videos, and just my eyes completely burn out. I lose my vision. It's hard to drive. Everything is terrible. So literally, I cannot spend so much time staring at a computer screen. So in this case, I'm outside. I'm looking at a distance. My vision, the field of depth of vision is changing, and my eyes are not getting wiped out. So there's that benefit. Secondly, there's a benefit simply of saving vast amounts of time. Which is a great benefit at these times. Able to tape more, take care of other things that are very important to take care of, and get the information, the satsang, out to all of you immediately, right on the dot. I can sit down at any moment and deliver whatever needs to be delivered right now. So that's another great benefit of doing this direct taping. The only drawback is I can't pause this. There is no pause button. That's a drawback. So it's all completely spontaneous, unrehearsed, and no way to stop it. But you know, that's actually nothing wrong with that. Nothing wrong with that. Just have to be very focused. And of course, it's not going to be smooth as some edited program would be, because it's direct recording, no pause. But I wonder if I couldn't get some contributors here to record here and add their perspective to this. I feel it's very important for a variety of perspectives to be presented. Not conflicting perspectives, but simply stylistic differences. Let's say you're having you're playing a song, you're a musician in a group, and you do the verses, and then you take an instrumental break. And in some groups, it's traditional. Each instrument has a little break. You know, the piano does its thing, the saxophone does its thing, the pedal steel does its thing. The drummer does their thing, the bass player, the violin, the guitar player, you know, all the various, the flute, the flautist does their thing. The various instruments have their little break, and they present their little vignette, their little riffs, you know, and it's nice. But they're all within the tempo of the song, right? They're all playing the same song, the same tempo, the same key. It's just, it gives a little variety. It's nice to hear. Now, it's important that to have a little bit of variety, I believe, is important so that a personality cult doesn't develop, which can be a very harmful thing, actually. If there's too much focus on the teacher, one teacher, and that's it, it's very possible for personality cults to develop, almost inevitable. The various spiritual traditions actually rotate their teachers, like the Catholic Church rotates priests constantly. They're there for a year or two, then they're gone somewhere else. And it's very difficult to develop a personality cult under those circumstances. People know that this priest is going to be gone very soon, so just, you know, cannot get into that. And someone new. In other traditions, in some traditions, the students are sent to different teachers. They spend a little time with one, they go to another, then they go to another, then another. And that way, they focus on the message, the clarity, rather than on the messenger, the person, the persona. So I believe, you know, that the highest types of teachers actually bring in other teachers, substitute teachers, different variety of teachers to also address the satsang. They say, you know, I'm going to take a couple days break, and I'm going to bring in this teacher, and they're going to address you and give you their clarity, and you'll find it very refreshing. It's a little slightly different style to it, and it will really broaden your horizons to hear this, that type of thing. I know Ananda Mai Ma did that very much. She actually would attend other satsangs of other teachers and attract people to those satsangs, and she herself wouldn't say anything. At times in her satsang, she would always bring in other teachers to address everybody, to broaden the focus. It's not just on her, but to realize, hey, there's lots of other teachers around too. I may have to leave soon, but here's this teacher here, you can listen to them. They'll be very helpful for you. Oh, there we go again. The ubiquitous cell phone. Excuse me just 1 minute here.
Yeah, hello? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. That's great. That's great. Okay. Great. No rush. Okay. Thanks for calling. Okay. Bye.
All right. There you go. Now you know it's live. It's no joke. It really is live. So sometimes you have to take a call, right? and just keep right on trucking. I saw someone playing the pedal steel, and a brilliant player, and they broke a string. And they just kept, they were singing and playing, and they kept on singing and kept on playing at the same time, changed the string. It's unbelievable. They didn't stop and say, oh my gosh, we're gonna have to stop the song here. They just improvised, kept on going. So here in Satsang, you just keep on going. I mean, I have to take the phone call and address it. But then we're right back in the game. It's like changing a string. I'm still here. I don't have to say that's it and shut it down. Be back later. No. Get right back to it live. When you're live, interruptions will happen. Which is real, because that's your real life too. That's your real situation. Situations everyone's in is interruptions happen. And we have to know how to handle those interruptions. Do not get flustered. I know it's tough because you think, oh, I'm just on the brink of such great insight and I'm really feeling clarity, and suddenly it gets interrupted and thrown into chaos, which the world will do. Don't get flustered at all. Just deal with the situation calmly and then get back to it, get back in the groove. Tempo, the groove is still there. The groove is simple. Choose a new idea. Experience the peace beyond understanding. It's very simple. Truth is very simple, and yet we lose sight of it. We're trying to forget what we are. We're trying to experience being prime creator. We're pretending that we're experiencing it. We're trying to distract ourselves from remembering what we are. And that's what's happened in existence, but now we're changing that direction and saying, no, I want to give up that distraction. I want to lessen the distraction. Now, interruptions are not distraction per se, because the whole context of this planet is distraction. Distraction is when one lets the interruption throw them off the track. Then distraction has happened. But again, success is the best revenge. So if you're upset about it being distracted, just get back to not being distracted. And realize that what you are can never be harmed or attacked or diminished or changed in any way. And all dreams of any sort of attack or diminishment or fragmentation have to be a dream. It's unreality, an illusion, a mirage, fantasy. Reality cannot be modified, cannot be changed, cannot be harmed, diminished, fragmented, and cannot be modified in any way. So anything that we're aware of as being modified, that's not real. It's only a wish, wishful thinking. It's a hallucination, actually, so to speak. It's like a spiritual hallucination. Spirit is imagining all this. It's like a dream. It's a dream of forgetfulness of what we are. And the ego's agenda is to distract us from choosing a new idea, which would bring about perfect remembrance of what we are. The ego's job is to distract us from that. So the purpose of the world is distraction. And we can give our time here a different purpose, which is to drop distraction and instead choose a new idea. Instead of trying to be prime creator, we choose the idea of not trying to be prime creator, not trying to experience that. And that gives rise to the overlay, which gives rise to perfect remembrance of what we are. And there we go. Very simple. So getting back in the groove is not difficult. So don't fear distraction, just don't engage with it. I know it's tough, but what can we do? Everybody's in the same boat. You cannot wait until you're in a perfect situation where there's no distraction. It doesn't work that way. You have to do the best you can wherever you are. obviously with bodies in this world, everybody is someplace, located somewhere. And so wherever we are, we have to do the best we can. And don't you make any excuses for not doing the best we can wherever we are. Hopefully things get better for us. But not always. You know, sometimes the going is tough. But there again, that's when the tough get going. Now this world right now is at the tipping point, really. It's really at the tipping point. Has been teetering there for a while. Like teetering on a cliff, a car teetering on a cliff. And we're thinking, is it going to go over the cliff or not? And we're going through this terrible angst as we see this car teeter-totter on the edge of a cliff. And we're thinking, is it going to go? Or is it somehow we're going to be able to drag it back on the road? And we're just hoping that a big, strong gust of wind doesn't come along. Tip the balance. But remember, as I've said, certainly in part two of this Satsang-A-Thon, and alluded to in this one, that there's an enormous number of people here in this world who are here precisely because they want the car to go over the edge. They want to experience the calamity here, the troubles. Because that provides them the distraction that they crave, that they need to prevent them from turning towards truth. Prevents them from turning towards remembrance of what they are. Because they believe that what they are is no longer, has been destroyed, or that that it will be destroyed. There's nothing there for them. That if they turn towards what they are, they will find out that they're nothing, that they become annihilated. So distraction to them is life. Literally, they live on distraction, and they require distraction. They demand it. All their efforts are aligned with providing that distraction for themselves, and they're ruthless about it. Because to them, it's an issue of spiritual survival. Without it, they feel they'd be annihilated. So all their will is aligned in that direction to bring about distraction. And distraction means those things which help them forget what they are, which is, vulnerability, destructivity, death, sickness, misery, starvation, deprivation, fighting, conflict, chaos. All those things, that's what they crave. They crave it like no one else craves it, like a drug, severe drug, and they'll do anything and everything to get that. So they're here now in this world. They've set up this world to provide the experiences that they crave. And so they will certainly give a helping hand to it, give it a push, give that car a push, provide that gust of air that pushes it over the edge. Tips the balance. So we cannot just naively assume that the car is going to be pulled back on the road and everything, it will be fine. When goodwill prevails, you can assume that. You can always assume, people of goodwill, backed by countries of goodwill, backed by communities of goodwill, will get together and just, hash this out and say, okay, let's do what's best for everyone, and let's find a peaceful resolution to this, etc. You can count on that, but we don't have that situation so much anymore in the world. We have those who have a great appetite for destruction, and their will is that things happen, that the ball, the avalanche gets going. It starts snowballing. And then they get to jump on that bandwagon and rock and roll with their thing. They may go about engaged in mayhem. They may be waiting for that, so it's very possible the car will be pushed over the edge. Very possible during these times. One should not trust these times at all. I think anyone who does is a fool. That they must not be paying any attention to what's going on and are simply wishing, hoping and wishing. Now, praying for peace is something that I don't think I can speak out against. But remember that in existence, the purpose of existence is forgetfulness of what we are. So praying for peace is like saying we need to, within the context of this idea of trying to be prime creator and trying to forget what we are, we need that to be peaceful forgetting of what we are, which isn't really possible. What one should pray for is pray for clarity. The clarity to see what one's options really are. And then one will see that, if I choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator, I will then actually be abiding in perfect peace. I'll be like Ramana Maharshi. Guaranteed. If one chooses a new idea. So that then will actually have a very positive effect because people will, the conductor will be there, and people will suddenly pick up their instrument and say, all right, let's play along with this conductor here. The singer, the lead singer has arrived. Let's get our instruments and let's start playing a song. So that will have a great positive effect. But merely praying for peace, I'll tell you, those who have an appetite for destruction and distraction have a more powerful will than those who are praying for peace. Much more powerful will. Because they're coming from a place of feeling that if they don't get what they want, they'll be annihilated. For those who are praying for peace are not coming from that. They're saying, well, we like peace. Peace would be pleasant for us. We prefer peace, but if we don't get it, well, you know, oh well. See, that's a different level of will entirely. Because if one is truly praying for peace, one should know then that annihilation is impossible. And there's no such threat. They don't feel a sense of threat like that. And so their sentiments are good towards peace, but the will of those who literally believe, entirely believe that they will be annihilated if they don't get the distraction that they need, they are much, much more forceful and adamant and active towards what they want. History of this planet is that those who pray for peace, not sufficient. Hostilities still break out. Prayer is not as powerful as we would have been led to believe, to tell you the truth. Actually, the ego sponsors it because it knows it's ineffective. It gives the patina of being oriented towards peace, but without actually choosing a new idea, without actually choosing the peace beyond understanding. So those who are praying for peace think they are engaged in great spiritual endeavors. But by doing that, their attention is distracted away from the true satsang of considering choosing a new idea and experiencing the presence of perfect isness, perfect peace beyond understanding. Only that reminds us of what we are, which is spirit. Our purpose is to remember what we are. The purpose of existence is to forget what we are. The purpose of being freed from existence, choosing a new idea, is the purpose of remembering what we are. See, spirit wants to remember what it is. God wants spirit to remember what spirit is. That is the truth. That's actually God's will, that we choose a new idea. Not that we're forced into it, but that God wants us to function the way that we were created to function, instead of pretending to experience what God wants us to actually experience. So we're continuing these themes, reinforcing these themes for you. That what we're doing here is we're pretending to experience what we God, the way God created us to actually experience. And we can never actually experience being prime creator. We can only pretend to experience. And staying within a situation of severe conflict and simply praying for peace is not actually a very wise option. Because those people who feel that their very spiritual existence depends on generating severe distraction for themselves, they have no mercy. They're not going to respond to someone merely saying, no, you should have peace, you should peace. From their standpoint, those who are praying for peace are praying for their annihilation. That is literally their viewpoint. And their logic is consistent within the context of the false premise that it's arising from. So they think they're being entirely logical. And that is, those who are praying for peace are being illogical. That those who are praying for peace are demanding their extinction, actually. Their annihilation, spiritual annihilation. So you have that dynamic here. And you have to be wise about that. The idea of somebody standing up in front of the advancing army, praying for peace, and the army suddenly stopping and saying, oh, okay. No, that's spiritual romanticism. Doesn't work that way. Ananda Mayama, perfect peace, established in perfect peace. She didn't stop conflict. She didn't stop the partition of Bengal. East Bengal, that partition. Bengal was partitioned into East and West Bengal. And it turned into East Pakistan. And she didn't stop all of that. She didn't stop World War II, World War I. Didn't stop the Korean conflict, didn't stop the Vietnamese conflict, etc., etc., etc. And didn't even stop her devotees who stayed in Dhaka from being massacred, which they were. The temple there, the Mandir, in Ramna Park, had a great many devotees. She warned them to leave. They were warned to leave. They decided to stay. And during the wars of liberation there, they were when East Pakistan was trying to liberate itself from West Pakistan, and West Pakistan was cracking down on that liberation movement. All of the chief priests of the Mandir and the devotees there, longtime devotees, etc., were all taken out and executed, and the Mandir was burned to the ground, destroyed. I think it was a Kali Mandir or something like that. It's a very ancient sacred temple, Hindu spiritual spot, very sacred, very long, had great longevity to it, very significant place. It was absolutely destroyed, and all those in there were executed. And so she didn't even stop that. So, and look at Jesus, he didn't stop the destruction of Israel or Judea. He said, he warned everyone, hey, you know, you start this revolution, the Romans will come in and destroy this place, and one stone will not be left upon another. He didn't stop that at all. That's exactly what happened. You got to look at that. You have to conclude that perfect peace is not about stopping events in this world, not about stopping destruction in this world. It's about overlaying everything in this world, the good, the bad, and the ugly. It's about experiencing the presence of that perfect peace, that perfect still isness. It's about remembering what one is, what one really, what one's identity really is, which is spirit. That's what it's about. And whether war is taking place or not doesn't matter from that standpoint, because the only purpose we have is to remember what we are. And what we are is not at war. What we are can never be at war, has never been at war. Life cannot attack itself. Life cannot threaten itself. Reality cannot attack itself or threaten itself at all. And we need to be reminded of that fact. As long as we're tilting at windmills here in this world, trying to bring peace to this planet, we're overlooking this primary fact, what we really need to do. We're saying, yeah, attack can happen. We have to put in all these safeguards and work really hard to try and minimize it. How is that reminding us of what we are? What we are cannot be attacked. Has never been attacked, will never be attacked. Cannot be diminished, cannot be harmed in any way, ever. And we need to be reminded of this truth. And the way to be reminded of this truth is to choose a new idea, the idea of not trying to be prime creator. And that gives rise to this effect, which is non-modified effect, not being modified at all. This effect is called the perfect stillness, the presence of this isness, the presence of isness, vision of oneness, vision of Christ, nirvana, etc. We need to experience that, abide in that, and experience that effect to be reminded of what we are. It's the only way. And then we'll say, ah, this whole existence is just a dream of imagination trying to deceive us into thinking we're something other than what we are. It was designed to get us to induce forgetfulness of what we are. That's all it is. So we can drop the whole thing. We don't need to change anything about it, because we know we now have the perfect reminder of what we are, and we know that only this flawless, perfect reminder can remind us of how flawless and perfect we are. It will always be a completely flawed, horrible reminder of what we are. No matter what we do, this world will always actually be a severe forgetfulness of what we are, no matter what we do. Even if there's no hostilities on the face of this planet, this world still will be generating complete, intense forgetfulness of what we are. Because everything's being modified. Whether it's peaceful or not, still going to be complete, total forgetfulness of what we are, or at least deep forgetfulness. I can't call it total, because the remembrance will always be there. It'll always come. Deep down, we have attraction to what we are, and we can never get rid of that. So let's say deep forgetfulness of what we are. That'll always be there with existence, always, no matter what the conditions are. Any variations are exceedingly minor. One might say, well, if we get peace on the whole face of the earth, then a golden age will break out. No, it won't. Whatever breaks out will still be steeped in deep forgetfulness of what we are. I mean, certainly a different age will break out, a different style of forgetfulness, seemingly. But that has nothing to do with remembrance of what we are. We might have an age of developing all sorts of psychic powers. We've done that before. Developing all sorts of, you know, mental powers and stuff. Subtle energies, etc., etc. Again, none of that reminds us of what we are. Reality doesn't run on energy. Doesn't run on power, subtle powers, or anything like that. It runs on essence, runs on manifestation, runs on pure creativity, direct experiencing. Spirit choosing ideas, mind presenting ideas, spirit experiencing those ideas. All within the totality of the oneness that the prime creator holds as its will. That's reality. This world here does not remind us of reality at all. Only the faintest crumbs, you know, slightest faint tinge. Sometimes we'll get that slight faint tinge. But those are crumbs. It's better to spend time in satsang, being reminded of it, directly reminded of these facts, than to go seek for some slight faint tinge. So why try and change the world? Why try to do anything about it? Let it be. Let it play out the way it plays. It will always play. Sometimes there'll be conflict. Sometimes there'll be lessening of conflict. It's a mad swirl. Cosmos, you know, plays out. It's all a vast pressure gradient. Pressure gradient is constantly moving, shifting, changing. It's dynamic. Modification is always taking place. So why focus on even positive modification? What we are doesn't need any modification. What we are is perfect. We need to be reminded of that. And anything that is not going towards reminder of that fact is forgetfulness. No matter how altruistic we make it sound. Again, Ananda Mayama, what did she do when all the problems were raging about her? There were so many problems with the Indian independence. At that time, the independence went from England, from the British Commonwealth, and then the partitioning into Pakistan and India. So many problems, really. Horrible things were taking place all around her. She was in Calcutta, you know, where just drastic stuff was happening, really. And she didn't even react to it as if anything were happening at all. To her, nothing was happening. Nothing that affected peace that she was experiencing. The perfect peace beyond any understanding was completely untouched by anything that takes place. And there again, she would remind everyone, you must focus on choosing a new idea. You must focus on experiencing this perfect peace. That's the remedy. The world will continue to boil. The world is a boiling pot at all times. Sometimes it boils over, sometimes it doesn't boil over, but it's always boiling. And you know when you're cooking that sometimes it's boiling and the lid won't be blown off by, you know, won't boil over. Sometimes it will boil over. The world is like that. Sometimes it boils over. But there again, she was there at the Kumbh Mela in, was 1954? Something like that, could have been earlier, and 52 or whatever. And that's the one where the terrible stampede happened and so many people were crushed to death. She was there, she actually saw it all taking place before it took place, and she didn't stop it. Because that's the play of existence. It's not the purpose of enlightened ones to try to interfere with the play of existence. I guess sometimes they may do certain things for devotees, etc., to help them out in some ways. But, for instance, her husband was caught the smallpox, the bad variety, and obviously he was going to die. She didn't do anything. She, you know, other than maybe soothe his pain at the very end, but she didn't cure him. Her closest disciple also got sick and died. She didn't interfere with that, saying that, you know, that was the play of karma, meaning the play of forgetfulness. What karma really means is the play of forgetfulness, our investment in forgetfulness playing out with the body, with the personality. And so we all have that play of forgetfulness that we've been engaged in, identified with, and believe we need. And so we attract it to us. We aim for it. We want to be distracted. And so it comes. It comes in different forms. In Bolana's case, her husband, it came in a form of smallpox. And he died from it. But she realized that's the play of forgetfulness, the play of distraction, and that's what he wanted. He wanted to remain distracted in some way. Maybe after going through that, he'll say, you know what? That didn't work either. Maybe I don't want any more distraction. So it's hard to fathom why teachers sometimes intervene, why they don't sometimes intervene. They might intervene when someone calls a distraction to themselves, and then they repent and say, you know what, I really don't need this. And then maybe they can take action. Like I think her husband was bit by a cobra, one of her close disciples was bit by a cobra very badly. Or what was it? That was one instance. Another instance, she actually stuck her foot out and was bit by a cobra that someone else was about to step on. And she took the cobra bite on herself and prevented it from someone else from being bit by the cobra. And then she cured herself, just nothing. Really didn't cause any trouble for her at all. There are things like that that do happen. She saved someone from drowning once. I think it was by she saved him from drowning in the Ganges, pulled him out. Because she could determine that his desire for distraction really did not require that he experience death by drowning. That he maybe had repented to a significant extent, so that was would not interfere with his path. Because if one interferes with the path, it can have actually bring about delay. If one really wants to be distracted, because they fear that they're going to be annihilated if they're not distracted, then taking away that distraction can bring up the fear of annihilation, which can then lead them into grabbing hold of even worse distractions. See, it's a very tricky thing. The guru cannot come in and wave a magic wand and get rid of all troubles. It doesn't work like that. Because again, those who are trying to forget what they are, they believe the ego, and the ego tells them that what they are, if they try to remember what they are, they will experience complete annihilation. So they're terrified of this, and they see distraction as the means to peace of mind, the means of life. It's literally life to them, distraction. And they're willing to have the body die over and over and over just so that they feel their spirit can live. They're willing to sacrifice, they're willing to be fried just so they can believe, the sacrifice of this body distracts me enough so that I won't try to look and see, remember what I am. And so that keeps me, my spirit going, keeps my spirit alive. So it's nothing to sacrifice the body for the sake of keeping the spirit alive. That's their rationale. So if a guru interferes with this in some way, that, you know, that could develop more karma for them, more severe distraction. Karma, I mean, just distraction, the distraction of forgetfulness, and how we play with that, and how we ask for it, and receive it, and believe in it. That's all that it is. But ultimately, one doesn't need any karma at all. One chooses a new idea, no karma. Where's the karma? It's not necessary. And Anandamayi had no karma. Didn't come in the world because of karma. So had no forgetfulness. None. Apparently never had any. Never had asked for forgetfulness. Never chose to try and be prime creator, experience being prime creator. Always knowing that God is greater. Jesus, same way, said, I am one with God, but God is greater. Meaning that reality is one. All is one in reality. There's no separation at all. So of course, saying I am one with God, of course, all is one with God. There's only one. There's no fragments. There's no parts to reality. And then he said, but God is greater, meaning God is the prime creator. I'm the Son of God, the prime created. The extension of God, but not the origin. I'm not the origin of myself. Very, very important distinction. And had perfect clarity about that. And therefore could teach point us very clearly towards the remedy. And yet our karma, that means our involvement with forgetfulness and all the tactics that we are familiar with using to remain distracted from remembering what we are, those continue to play with us. We stay involved with that. That's what we call karma. So every time we die, all those tendencies are still with us, and we get another body, and we continue to play, continue to be distracted, continue our play of distraction. Afterlife too, we continue a play of distraction. After the body drops, we continue to play a distraction. Spirit does. Spirit can't die. So when the body's dropped, spirit is still 100% there. And if spirit hasn't repented and decided to remember what it is, it'll continue its play in the subtler realms in the body, with subtle bodies. And then those subtle bodies will clothe themselves in a fleshy body and continue to play a distraction as it's accustomed to. That's all that karma really is. So we cannot necessarily pull karma away from someone and say no, because then they may grab hold of something even worse, even more distracting. You see how it works like that. The best way is to attend satsang, listen to truth, and then one will start saying, hey, you know what? I don't really need that karma. I don't really need that severe distraction anymore. It's not necessary. And then there, one will not attract it to them. And one could get free of that particular type of distraction. One can even get free of the world and free of existence. One can say, you know what? I don't even need existence anymore. I'll take the overlay of it. For sake of continuity, I'll take the overlay. I'll take the peace, perfect peace. I'll take that instead. I'll choose a new idea and take that. Because all this, everything else is just forgetfulness of what I am. I don't need that anymore. I know I won't be annihilated if I choose to remember what I am. Because what I am cannot be harmed in any way. That's the key experience I had in 1978. I believe it was in October of that year. Where I literally experienced reality for a brief moment. And I saw that everything there was immaculate, and it can never be harmed in any way. It was completely obvious. And from that, then I realized all this egoic agenda is nonsense. It's all based on a lie that we can be annihilated somehow. It's all based on fear. All fear is based on a lie. And then I began to work on disentangling from my karma, so to speak, meaning from distraction, from forgetfulness. It's very simple. You start using the leverage and realize the ego really doesn't have any true leverage. Its leverage is based on a lie. That's not true leverage. Jesus said, build your house on a rock, don't put it on straw. Because when the winds blow, the house that's built on straw is going to crumble. House built on solid rock, it's going to stay steady. Solid rock is truth. Solid rock is experiencing the presence of isness. And the effect that can't be modified, that non-modifiable effect, that reminds us that reality cannot be touched by dreams of its destruction. And that we remember what we are. That's the solid rock. That's the foundation of solid rock. Foundation the ego puts up is all lies. That's the foundation of straw. And that will crumble. When the winds blow, that gets the house gets totally unstable, and everybody starts screaming and freaking out. And then they say, I need some more severe distraction. And they want the distraction. The world wants, the karma of this world is so severe, meaning the desire for severe distraction on this planet is so severe right now. If you could look at the planet and symbolize it, it looks like there's a dark, covered with some very dark clouds. Heavy, heavy, menacing dark clouds, meaning this appetite for destruction, experiencing calamity, very strong here. And it's no place for those who are not interested in that anymore. I think the days of bucolic country club living and everything seems nice and peaceful and stable, etc., are, about ready to become extinct here. We've had uprisings in the Middle East, the Arab Spring, etc., and then we've had the 99% uprising here in Western world, and it giving notice that, hey, it's not business as usual anymore. The spirit of revolution is in the air. And once that gets rolling, you know, there's no stopping it. And who knows who gets caught up in it. According to one's karma, they got caught up in it. I mean, Ananda Mai Ma, one of her devotees had a sort of an imbecilic child or something, and that child wandered off and fell into a well and died. And Ananda Mai Ma said that she foresaw that happening. And then the devotee got extremely upset, said, "Why didn't you stop it?" And she said, "Well, that was his karma." And so what does that mean? It means that's what that child wanted, meaning child in physical form only. That's what that spirit wanted. Spirit wanted for that physical form of the child to die in a well, to provide the distraction that spirit wants to, so that spirit will not try to remember what spirit is. This provides a distraction. It provides a forgetfulness of what spirit is. That's what that spirit wanted. And so she saw that. And she says, it's not for me to interfere. Because if I interfered, that spirit would grab hold of something even worse. And the devotee had a hard time understanding that. I guess that was never forgiven. I don't know. Maybe at some point it was, might have been forgiven. But people expect the guru to protect them from all harm, protect them from all karmas, etc. It doesn't necessarily happen that way. Now, karma can be shifted in various ways. Substitutes can be used, artfully used, that give people opportunities. But if the opportunity isn't taken, then what's the use? If it's seen that an opportunity will be taken, then a shifting of karma in some ways can take place. And one might sidestep a situation. What we're trying to do here is sidestep this, the future of this planet. That's sidestepping a lot of karma. A lot. A ton of karma. And I'm saying it's definitely possible to sidestep it. And I certainly ask the gurus to do it. Those who have perfect remembrance of what they are, you know, they're capable of setting up situations that enable us to sidestep that karma. If we are sufficiently focused on satsang, and have momentum to realize that we don't need any karma, we don't need any forgetfulness of what we are, then karma is useless for us. It serves no purpose. So sidestepping it is very doable. We may not find ourselves perfectly free of it, but we may be able to sidestep it, you see. Sidestepping gives us the opportunity to finish up our satsang and choose a new idea. Whereas if we're enmeshed in the karma of this world, we might get delayed, unnecessary delayed, from choosing a new idea and then experiencing the perfect isness, that stillness, that ever-present calm, the untouched calm that overlays all of existence. That's here right now, exactly as it's always been here, exactly as it always will be here, with no change. It just simply is. It's not advertising itself. It's not trying to be anything, not saying anything, not going anywhere. It's just reposing within itself. In perfect bliss, perfect peace, perfect calm, perfect stillness. Perfect spaciousness, perfect emptiness, perfect no-thingness, perfect non-modification, perfect oneness, perfect seamlessness, perfect peace, just is, effortlessly is, that effortless isness. We can certainly choose to abide in that by choosing a new idea, because this perfect presence of isness doesn't come from existence. It's not generated by any process of existence. It's not generated by nature. It's not a product of nature. It's not even a product of supernature. It's a product of a different idea. It's an effect of a different idea. It's not manufactured by anything. It's the manifestation of another idea. It's the effects of another idea. That's it. That's why sometimes it's called a miracle. But it's not really a miracle. It's not altering anything that unusual. It's simply the effect of a different idea. Perfectly normal. Perfectly in alignment, as you would expect. Perfectly reasonable. Nothing odd happening whatsoever. Nothing's being overcome. Nothing's being changed. The idea that the peace beyond understanding is miraculous because it's stable. And we think, how could anything in nature be stable? This isn't from nature. It's not a product of nature. It's not part of nature. In the world, but not of it. Meaning, it overlays nature, but it's not coming from nature. And we're covering a lot of ground here on this Memorial Day Satsang-A-Thon. Satsang-A-Thon. Covering a lot of territory, as would be expected. That's the whole purpose of the Satsang, is territory is covered. Moving fast. Panoramic. Wide perspective, we're able to paint with broad strokes, not getting bogged down in minutiae, not getting bogged down in questions. There's a value in this sort of monologue, actually, because it's not being interrupted by questions, personal concerns, petty concerns, little things, details, interrogations, prove your credentials, all these things. Not being bogged down. One can simply watch the picture being painted. There it is, broad stroke on the canvas. Beautiful. Just this bold, bright, broad stroke, whoosh, on the canvas like that. And there it is. And all we do is just sit back and look at it and say, wow, I really like that stroke. That's really very, very nice. And then another stroke is applied to the canvas, and another stroke. And we just watch these strokes being applied to the canvas, and we get out of it as we play the instrument, so we hear the tune. So we get out, what we get out of it is based on what we put into it. From our perspective, everyone has a different perspective, so everyone will see it slightly differently. But the broad strokes continue to be applied to the canvas. Everyone can make of it what they will, but there aren't any, interludes. Now, there's nothing wrong with addressing questions from people. Maybe that's something that can be part of the satsang. I think that traditionally that's the center of it in a lot of places, but I think monologue is very important. But people come personally, they want to have a personal connection with the teacher or something. They want to ask questions and feel that the teacher cares about their personal life, etc. Even though it's not quite like that, really. And, so it, but as I'm saying, monologue can be very helpful. No pressure on anyone to ask any questions. No one viewing this feels they need to ask any questions. Just enjoy the painting. Just smile, be happy, get out of it what you can. That's all. Nobody will connect with it entirely, really. Very doubtful. Everyone sees the teaching differently. Everyone sees clarification slightly differently. And so, of course, nobody agrees with everything that's being said. It would be very rare for that to happen. And even if they do, they might feel, stylistically, they'll have differences. They'll say, yeah, I get it, but I would present it in this way. It'd be a little different way of presenting it. That's absolutely par for the course. So what one does is simply get everything that one can out of it. Find the nuggets, find the gold, find the help, find the clarifications. Don't worry about what other people are getting, because they'll be getting it in a different way, slightly different way, no question about it. And you might, your clarity, you compare notes and you kind of say, well, wait a minute, you know, I see it this way and you see it that way and it's different. And I think this is really great. And you think, well, something else is, and yeah, it's different. Everybody's different. That's why satsang is often called quiet. You don't compare notes. Don't compare notes. But there's some utility, I believe, in addressing people come up. That's the traditional Indian way of doing it. People come up and they ask questions. At least it is in some traditions. And the letters are read. They read letters. I suppose I could do that. I don't know if it's necessary or not. I could leave an email address, and or people could actually write questions on this video. Just post a question here on the video, and maybe I'll get to it, maybe I won't. I don't know. That's possibility. Possibility. But by and large, questions, in my experience, I don't know. It's hard to say if it's really how helpful it really is. Maybe sometimes it is, sometimes it isn't. It's probably a mixed bag. I guess it gives the teacher an opportunity to launch into a monologue is what it does. Under the guise of answering the question. But for some reason, people want to ask questions. And I can understand that. But if one really gets into just purely experiencing the monologue, watching the broad strokes, listening to the broad strokes with open ears, I think there's a different level of satisfaction and clarity, a different level, higher level. Because one can quietly just say, aha, there's no need for any comeback. No need to answer back or come up with some other question or anything. Just like pure recognition. Just see it, hear it, and say, aha, yeah, aha. And then on to the next. More ahas. Okay, see it. Good, great. Maybe more food can be eaten that way. Like, I suppose different teachers have different ways of going about it. Here we're just hammering away at this monologue and putting up big strokes of very vivid clarification, very adamant. Has to be adamant. Has to show the remedy. Has to be adamant enough to see what the remedy must be. The impossibility of spirit experiencing itself as prime creator must be brought to the front and directly confronted and say, it's impossible. No, we cannot. I think that's the mantra of the path. No, we cannot. No, we can't. The mantra of the ego is, yes, we can. That's the mantra of the ego in many forms, like nothing is impossible. If you can dream it, you can do it. That's the mantra of the ego. Yes, we can. In other words, yes, we can experience being prime creator. That's what the ego has to tell us, has to lie to us. Born liar. In other words, the necessity of lying to ourselves, that necessity we call the ego. There's no being or entity that is the ego. The ego is just a term meaning basically mind lying to us, because mind has to. We told mind to lie to us, basically. We said we want the experience to be experienced ourselves as prime creator. So mind has no choice but to lie to us and say, yes, you can. And so that's his mind doing. So all that lying out of necessity that is being done in existence, we call that the ego. That's why I say the ego is born of a lie, meaning it's from the very beginning, mind had to lie. Mind didn't start out saying, well, spirit, you know what, you can't really do that. And then spirit said, oh, really? And the mind said, yeah, but you can't really do it, but you know, you might be able to do something here or there. Now mind came out of the chute, immediately said, yes, you can. Okay, done deal. Here it is. Here it is, right out of the chute. That's how mind is. Mind spontaneously imagined this entire scenario immediately. Here it is. This is it. Yes, you can. what it really means is, yes, you can fall into deep forgetfulness of what you are. That's what it's really saying. But it cannot directly say those things. Only the voice of reason, Holy Spirit, can say that. So that's in satsang. That's why you can hear these things that the mind cannot say to you. The mind presenting the idea of yes, we can be experienced being prime creator, cannot speak truth. It always hedges everything. You can tell the difference. It has to hedge everything. You feel like the mind is slippery and in lying and deceiving and getting into plausibility, hedging it's this way and that way and all of that slimy stuff. It's but just, you know, the way the world works, right? The way the world finances like that, right? It's all an expression of the mind. Yes, we can do the impossible. But in order to do that, we've got to do all this work, you know, all this funny business. Of course, the world financial system is resting on a foundation of funny business because it's resting on a foundation of ego, which is a lie. It's all lies. It's all saying, we can, but it really can't. But it's hiding the fact that it can't. Playing both sides. It's the game of plausibility. Very slippery slope. The house is resting on a foundation of straw. Fact is that the world financial system is resting on a foundation, a rotten foundation. Foundation that can't possibly support the weight of it all. When an unexpected event comes about, black swan event, one that we did not foresee, the weight suddenly gets heavier, the straw breaks the camel's back. The wood, let's say we have a house resting on foundation that's been termited, completely termited. It's very, very weak. And we have a big party in the house, and there's like, you know, a couple hundred people in the house, and boom, suddenly the house collapses. Foundation gives way. And like the Golden Gate Bridge, we think it's indestructible. And then in the 50-year anniversary, they had, I don't know how many people. We're walking across it, 100,000, a couple hundred thousand or something, some huge number of people were on the bridge at the same time, and actually the bridge began sagged down 7 feet. The towers pulled toward each other by 7 feet. They didn't expect that. You know, they didn't expect that many people to be walking on it, so the 75th anniversary, they banned that. You know, no, none of that. They didn't shut it down, let the crowds go across it. That'd be an unexpected consequence, something unexpected occurrence of those kind of crowds. So unexpected occurrences can come at us from an angle we don't even expect. Of course, we don't see it coming, and it puts too much weight on the camel. Boom, the camel's back breaks. But enough, when the load is heavy enough, it only takes one more straw, right? At some point, it only takes one more straw. Up to that point, we think the camel's fine. We see the camel sagging, we see the huge load it's carrying, but there's no really indication it's suddenly going to give way. And then finally, when that one more straw, finally the final straw, boom, that's it. Camel collapses. So how far can we push this situation that's resting on a rotten foundation? A foundation, an egoic foundation. A lying foundation, a hedged foundation. Everything's hedged in so many ways. End up getting in each other's way. The financial system is so complex now that it's out of anyone's control, to tell you the truth. Nobody's controlling it. It's a Frankenstein. There's so many, many instruments of hedging and circuitous loops this way and that way, and the ego trying to have it this way and that way and trying to say, yes, we can, and here's how we do it, but that causes problems over here, so yes, we can, we're going to hedge it this way also, and then that way. It's like a house of cards, building a house of cards. Yes, we can, but in order to do that, we have to do that, this and this and this and this and this and this and this. And it goes on and on and on and on, trying to hide the fact that no, we can't. So financial systems become more and more complex. And eventually, the straw breaks the camel's back. discuss this attitude. Yes, we can. Yes, we can give everyone a home. Yes, we can do that. Yes, we can give everyone medical care. Yes, we can solve all the problems of the world. Yes, we can do that. The ego is always saying that. Yes, we can do it. We can make this world a wonderful, attractive place, so we're satisfied with being here, and we don't even need to remember what we are. We're happy with this home and this identity. As a person living in this world, we say, oh, that's fine. We're very happy with it. We've got a utopia here. Well, in trying to get there, everything gets hedged more and more and more and more and more. Gets more and more and more toxic. Contagions, toxicity, rottenness gets into it. You know, a rotten apple spoils the whole barrel. You hedge enough, you're going to get so much rottenness in there that the whole system eventually implodes. And nobody really knows what the heck happened, you know. It's hard to figure out. Because everybody is doing what they think is, yes, we can for them. And yet having to hedge that by the ego's advice so that it gets hidden. The no, we cannot is hidden. So the no, we cannot keeps being buried and hidden within the very structure of it all. Ego can never get rid of it. It only move it around, shuffle it around. It's a shell game, really, which is taking place, a vast, vast shell game where the toxicity and weakness of the system is continuously shuffled around and tried to be buried and hidden, or no one really knows where it is or what it's doing. But again, as building a house of cards, it becomes more and more unstable, more and more unstable over time. And the addiction cannot be broken. We expect the bankers to break their addiction. They cannot. Because they're the ones at the forefront of the yes, we can. Because their job is to make it possible through loaning money. I mean, the ego says it to the world, yes, we can. Let's build a utopia here, and the banks are the way to do it. So banks, you know, lend everybody money so everybody can have a home, so we can build, make it a utopia, and the banks have to do it. The ego set it up so the banks had to do that. And so there's a lot of pressure on the banks from the ego to drive the engine of the world's economy. And the banks are all messed up because too much is being asked of them. They're not miracle workers. They cannot always pull a rabbit out of a hat and solve all the world's problems. You know, all the international treaties got to be pushed on the world. Same thing. Got to have equality, fairness, everyone treated fair, so we can look at the world and say, ah, what a great place this is. We don't need to remember what our real home is because we got this place. So enormous pressure is on the banks. In order to deal with that pressure and keep that spirit of, yes, we can meet all these goals, they have to hedge everything and engage in all sorts of self-deception, institutionalized deception, and bury it all and shuffle it around. So there's this rotten core to the whole situation. Deep down beneath everything buried is the foundation of the situation, and it's rotten. And some know this. Some know this very, very well. It's rotten. Can't go on forever. Cannot go on forever. So, spending time in satsang is a tremendous discipline. Very effective discipline. You begin to appreciate the big picture. And you begin to say, As far as forgetting what we are, no, we cannot. As far as experiencing being prime creator, no, we cannot. As far as choosing a new idea, yes, we can. So that's the right way to use yes, we can. Yes, we can realize that no, we can't. And yes, we can choose a new idea and drop the one that never can be experienced. We're just pretend experiencing. So no, we cannot actually experience being prime creator. But yes, we can experience not trying to be prime creator. We can experience that. Definitely, we can. Yes, we can do that. Well, there you go. So one becomes familiar with satsang and the discipline, the tenacity to pay attention to it, and realize it's not so tough, really. One just appreciates the broad strokes. Of course, the ego doesn't appreciate it at all. The ego listens to this and say, what the heck is this? This is terrible. Where's all the hedging, you know? Where's the burying of the no, we can't, you know? I mean, where is the deception, etc.? This is all way too direct and open and unhedged, and this is terrible. How can, this is not useful. And the ego says, ah, this is horrible for the ego. But for the spirit will say, ah, this is great. Really great. Love it. Love it. No, we can't. You know, very direct, basic. No, we can't experience being prime creator. Yes, we can choose a new idea. That simple. No, we can't. Yes, we can. And the fact that choosing this new idea gives rise to an effect that is, from the very beginning, immaculately still, unchanging, seamless, gentle, no turmoil, no change, still, perfectly still. Perfect peace. And we can experience that. It never changes, so we can experience that continuously. And that's what we need to do. Okay, it's time to wrap up this part 3 of the Memorial Day Satsang-A-Thon. Very great. And we'll see if we can do another little later on. Time to take a break. That's it.